pray for Jerusalem, oh God, for the peace of Jerusalem. I pray for our country, oh God, because you told us whose nation is blessed of you, oh God. Hallelujah, we a blessed nation all because of you, oh God. I pray for those who are in prison, oh God, that they receive their freedom, Lord, as long as their hearts are towards you, oh God. Hallelujah, let them continually seek your face. Hallelujah. We thank you, oh God. Hallelujah. For those who are in nursing homes, oh God, that who are lonely and don't have anybody, oh God, that you visit them on today, oh God. Hallelujah, that you be the father or the mother that they need, oh God. Hallelujah, those that don't have shelter, oh God, that you be their shelter on today, oh God. Hallelujah. Glory to God. We thank you, oh God. We praise you and we give you glory, oh God. We pray for our pastor on today, oh God, that he speak with the oracles of God, oh God. That he instructs us in truth and righteousness, oh God. Yes, my body. Glory to God. We thank you, oh God, that we bind the spirit of heaviness and oppression on today, oh God. We bind every spirit that's not like you, oh God. Hallelujah. You told us who the Son has set free is free indeed, oh God. We ask, oh God, that your blood prevail. Glory to God. Let it prevail over our lives. Let it prevail over our homes. Let it prevail over this service, oh God. We apply the blood of Jesus. Nothing can penetrate your blood. Hallelujah. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Come on, give the Lord a hand of praise on this morning. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Our scripture reading will come from Psalms 148th division. I will be reading verses 1 through 5. And it reads, praise ye the Lord. Praise ye the Lord from the heavens. Praise him in the heights. Praise ye him, all his angels. Praise ye him, all his hosts. Praise ye him, sun and moon. Praise him, all ye stars of light. Praise him, ye heavens of heavens, and ye waters that be above the heavens. Let them praise the name of the Lord, for he commanded, and they were created. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
Thank you. Hallelujah. He didn't redeem the angel. You in this presence, give them praise. You in this presence, let them Thank you.
they're such loving people. Yes. And just like the anointing flows from the head down, the loving kindness flows from the head down.
Amen.
I thank God because he's not possessive or jealous. He let me go off and help some other people. I was still a member here. And
amen.
I let him know about everything that was going on.
Yes.
But then, you know, they start kind of offering you positions and you say, Nehemiah has been too good to me. And I just want to thank you all because last year when I had my knee replacement, when I was in the hospital and in rehab, you all were so beautiful to me.
Thank you.
And I couldn't understand it because I haven't done anything for anybody here. And I look back over my life, how I used to go and put people on bedpans and clean them up. And one man, when I was pastoring, he had tuberculosis, and they thought he had it again. And they even got the doctors to beg me not to go into the room, but I said I had to go in and pray for him. So they put the thing on my head, the gown, the gloves, and all of that, the mask. And I went in and prayed for him, and whatever it was, he was out the hospital in 2 days.
Amen.
Hallelujah. People taught me that they can be like the lepers who just leave and it doesn't mean anything to them. And so I really love y'all. They couldn't pull me away over there.
Amen.
And
amen.
I just want to thank you for all your love and your kindness. You're just wonderful, blessed people. And I hope, and I know God is going to continue to bless you.
Amen. 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 Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.
Amen. Praise Jesus to the saints.
Hallelujah.
Praise Jesus to the saints.
Hallelujah.
Amen. To him who is beyond the comprehension of our lineage and beyond the explanation of any language dialect.
All right.
I just come to just bless him because he just worthy.
Yes.
And you know, when I first came here to the church, my daughter, she was in the midst of applying to go to Western Michigan, you know, and you know, they don't mind sitting in that field early, you know. We opened it up, you know, and she needed $26,000. And I said, okay, God, I got a task for you.
Amen.
You know, but I'm not, you know, I'm just, I release God to do what he want to do.
Amen. Amen.
I believe he's able.
Yes.
You know, I believe he will.
Yes.
But if not, I'm still going to bless him. You know, if she had to stop and apply to some little local college, I mean, if not, I'm still going to bless you. But you know, as the weeks progressed and time went on, you know, we saw the balance go down. You know, it was $26,000. And next week it was 21. Next week it was 19. And you know, in the end, she got $21,000 worth of scholarship.
Hallelujah.
Big bank account. You know, but I got a big faith account.
Yes.
I mean, we weren't worried about the money because I said, God, you gave them the mind.
Yes.
That's your responsibility.
Yes.
See? God, if you can't do what you said for you, you got to get off the throne and let somebody else sit in your spot. If you can't do what you said you were going to do, so you got to come with more than praise. You got to come with a holy life that makes the praise worthy.
Hallelujah.
Don't work by itself. You can shout all you want, but the praise don't work without the holy lifestyle.
Yes. Hallelujah.
You walk in God's house, you know you have done everything according to that word.
Yes.
You can say, God, it's your responsibility. I charge you to do something. I don't know what you're going to do.
Glory.
To do something. And all we had to pay was $5,000.
Thank you, Jesus.
My son, he got his Macomb County scholarship, and he got the first 2 years of college paid free and full.
Hallelujah.
See, that's why I come in church. I send up an SOS before God. SOS means scoot over some, because I'm getting ready to bless his name. So if you don't come to bless him,
hallelujah.
I'll make time for what I thank God for my children, Crystal, Elijah, and Amita. I thank God for what he's doing in my life.
Amen.
I thank him how he's even blessing me on my job. When for the most part that I know, when I went once saved, out of almost 800 people in this plant. People know me when I sing from the time I go in to the time I go out, 11, 12 hours a day, 4 days a week. And I just thank God that even my supervisor and everybody cusses like sailors. And even when he cusses in front of me, he says, oh, please forgive me. And I just thank God because it's nothing of myself. It's the true blessings of God that's living on the inside of me. And any chance that I get, people know, they'll come up to me, I'm praying for them continually, and I'm just asking God, use me to your will. And I just pray for each and every person that is here. If you make room for God, he will definitely make room for you.
Amen.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
That you remember your brother and sister. Praise the Lord. Brother Brown.
Praise the Lord, everybody.
Praise the Lord.
Like the mothers were babies, so I don't know anything.
anything about a cesarean. I know about it now, but beforehand, because I had all my children down to childbirth, and that's no doubt, that you know, nothing against anybody, but we have to go through what it is that we have to go through to get to where it is that we have to get to. Amen. And in the midst of that surgery, I did tell the doctor, I informed the doctor, said, the Lord also, for those that don't know, the Lord delivered me. Hallelujah.
Thank you. Tell you this, God have given me a great increase. And I just like giving. I just learned more and more. The more you give, the more he's going to bless you. When you learn how to release your substance to God, because it all belongs to him anyhow. And I'm finding out more and more, the more I give, the more God gives me. And he wants us to be givers. How many of you know God wants you to be a giver? And not grudgingly, but cheerfully. Because he has blessed each and every one of us. He may not give you the same amount of money, but he's blessed you with something. And God is asking you to give to him what rightfully belongs to him. And also we have the Building Fund campaign going. We've asked Pastor John, we've asked the leaders to give $400, and the rest of the members can give $200. But as he said, you can't give $200, whatever you can give, God knows. Amen. One thing about this church that I love, and we're going to stand to our feet while we're saying this. We've done so many beautiful things around here since we've been here. And every time I look, I say we just keep doing more and more. We're not giving the tithes and offer, take it up, and Pastor Jones riding around in the Bentley, he got a Learjet, he sold it back into the ministry. Amen. But one day we may get him a Bentley if the Lord keep blessing us. Amen. Because some people are hard on preachers. They complain, preachers making too much. I want more money on my job. So I have no problem with the preacher having nice things. We all should want nice. How many of y'all want nice things? Amen. Amen. See, y'all all, none of y'all crazy. And nobody say, not me. Amen. So we want to be a blessing to this kingdom. As you look around, you know, we don't have classrooms. We don't have a lot of things. But we have all things that we need for this time. Amen. Amen. But we're looking forward to God to move us somewhere else. And I've been looking for that land next door. He won't give in. I keep asking. But if he ain't gonna give us that, God got something else for us better. Amen. But your mind's clear. Offering lifted up. Lord, we thank you for the seed that you blessed us with. And we know that we are sowing these seeds in fertile ground, Lord. Expecting to receive a harvest according to your word and according to your will. We thank you, Lord, for giving us the substance that we have, Lord. Because everything I have, it belongs to you and him. I'm just giving it back to the rightful owner. We give you praise, honor, and glory. In Jesus' name, amen. You're now in the hands of the usher. If you don't have cash, we do have a debit card machine in the fellowship hall. And someone out there to service you in that capacity. Thank you. God.
Moses can see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man that trusted in him. Hallelujah. We give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good. And his mercy endures forever. I'm so grateful to all of the young ladies. Thank you for your thoughtfulness, your kindness, and your generous heart from Mother Luella. Sunday, August 5th, 2018, we have Sunday morning prayer in the sanctuary every Sunday morning, 10 o'clock a.m. Join us in prayer on Sunday morning to set the atmosphere for our service, amen? Sunday morning service, 12 noon. Wednesday Bible class, 7 o'clock p.m. Every Wednesday, 6 o'clock a.m., we have early morning conference call of prayer with the pastor. Conference number is 712-770-4128. The PIN is 415-008-POUND. Need a ride to church? Call the church office at 586-757-1075 by Friday, 5 o'clock p.m. Middies and young ladies, it is with great pleasure I invite you to tea time on next Saturday, August 11th, 12 o'clock to 3 o'clock p.m. Please see Sister Tiana Henley to RSVP. I do need a count for how many young ladies I will have so that we can make sure we have accommodations for everyone, amen? Mothers, please bring your young ladies to tea time. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Elevation service will be on Friday, August 24th, 7:30 p.m. This service will formally announce the newly appointed roles in ministry. Please come and celebrate with those being elevated. Again, that is on Friday, August 24th. Nehemiah's Temple, 9th Church Anniversary. Hallelujah. Voting can be September 21st through the 23rd. Our colors for the anniversary are navy blue, cream, and peach. We will also have a Saturday brunch. And tickets are now available, so please see Associate Pastor Lawrence. Nehemiah's Temple will participate in the Michigan State Council's first annual basketball tournament, ages 12 and up. For more details, please see Elder Gary Price Jr., amen? There will be a young people's meeting immediately after morning service today to discuss the camp. Your $45 registration fee is also due at that time. So please join Youth Pastor Mason for that meeting. And national registration dues are still being paid. So please see me immediately after morning service if you have not paid your registration dues. August birthdays. Sister Chantel Word, August 6th. Sister Tanisha Pollock, August 10th. Sister Asia Jordan, August 11th. Also, Sister Caitlin Mason, August 11th. And Sister Brigida Brown, August 11th. Sister Cassidy Dickerson, August 20th. Brother Aaron Wilson, August 21st. Sister Carla Brown, August 22nd. Brother Dwayne Clark, August 23rd. Also, Brother Gregory Day, August 23rd. Brother Gary Price III, August 26th. And Brother Gerald Williams Sr., August 31st. We'd like to wish all of you a very happy birthday during the month of August. This concludes your announcements. You are now in the hands of Associate Pastor Morris.
Amen. Praise the Lord, saints. Praise the Lord again. So just like it was mentioned in the previous announcement, we are getting ready for our anniversary. Our sixth annual prayer breakfast or luncheon this year is going on So I am passing out tickets to families right now. Now, as you know, every year, our expectation as Nehemiah's Temple family is that everyone comes to the lunch. Everyone is sponsored, well, not sponsored, but is asked to come to the lunch. Now, as far as prices for the tickets, for children 5 to 8 is $5. 9 to 12 is $15. 13 and up is $20. Now, I want you to understand the purpose of this luncheon is to celebrate what God has done for us down through the years. Our theme for today is following His plan. So as far as I can see, Nehemiah's Temple has always been blessed because what we followed His plan. If you have we're asking you to sponsor children, and also if there's any financial discrepancies, please either see myself, Evangelist Campbell, or Deacon Brown. Like I said, Pastor wants all of us to come so we can celebrate in the victory of the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
God bless you, and amen.
Amen. Put your hands together. Amen. Elder Gary Price Sr., amen, the pastor of the historic Apostolic Way Church of God. Amen. Put your hands together one more time. Also, youth camp is coming up real soon. I believe it's what, next week? The 15th through the 18th. Put your hands together for youth camp. And also, if you want to sponsor youth, you can sponsor youth. It's not too late. For $140, you can sponsor a youth and send them to youth camp. At this time, we are prepared for our choir to come forth. Amen. And next worship year, after the choir will be gathered, our pastor, Bishop Gully Light, Benjamin A. Jones. In that order, please.
Amen.
Put your hands together for the choir coming up. To help us lift up the name of Jesus. Thank you. tell you what I expect. I don't know what the schedule calls for, but on our anniversary, that'll be September 23rd. I'm expecting out of the choir to sing a couple of songs. We have a couple of series schedule. But also, we've been doing some recruiting. There's more brothers in the choir.
Amen.
One that day. Amen. So you brothers know me. You know I'm coming at you. I don't know why. I guess I got to do the recruiting. I'm going to be recruiting for the choir. So, you know I'm coming. When does the choir rehearse? Wednesdays after by, is that every Wednesday? Right, every Wednesday. I'm giving up that this is information. The choir rehearse every Wednesday after Bible class, 8 o'clock. And if you want to be part of the choir, see Mr. Reed, Mr. Truitt, join the choir and show up for rehearsal. Everybody needs to show up for rehearsal, because on the 23rd of September, we're going to rip this place. Yeah, it's going to rip the young people. And they probably won't say this no more. This is going to be all in pop. So I want all five members to take some notes. I want our youth that are away, that's going to be away in college, so would you come over that weekend? I'm going to ask you. Can I make a request?
Yes.
I want everybody home. Yes. It's our 9th anniversary. So you're away in college. I mean, I'm here in California. I'm going to have to hand you up for your ticket. But if you're in Michigan, nearby, come on. Everybody. If you got a job that's subject to want you to work on Sunday, I want you to take that day off. So, I'm going to leave that day off. Please. You can say please. Please. And then say may I. I want everybody home. It's our 9th anniversary. Twenty-third. Our 9th anniversary. So come on home. Everybody be in church and let us just have a great celebration. Don't plan to give away that weekend. If you plan one, don't tell them you need your money back. I sound like I'm not letting them off the hook, though. I'm not. Yeah. If you catch a cold, come to church. You can sit in the back. Well, everybody here, if your leg hurts, your arthritis act up. Bring Arthur and Iris to church. Yeah. So we're going to have a great time. I want everything to be in order. I want PA to be in order, everything working the cameras, everything is going to be in order. Deacons on duty, everything, ushers on full duty in proper attire, want everything in order. Somebody say amen.
Yes.
All right. Now I know that's, this kind of sounds like a saints meeting. But if I call a saints meeting, y'all ain't coming. So I got to get it when the saints show up. Amen. God bless you. So we want to go to choir rehearsing. Read on to work them hard. I push. If they complain, call me. I push everybody. Drummers, Corey, and pushing everybody. Yeah, we all gonna push. We expect to have a great time.
Thank God for all of you that are here today. I'm grateful to see so many of you here. You know that we've had people vacationing, and then you had some people sick and the other, but we want you to know that we're glad to see you, so glad to see Sister Michelle. I hadn't seen her. She's been sick, looking well. God bless you. Amen. God is certainly good. Thank God for all of our visitors. If you're here for the first time, would you please stand? If this is your first time here, please stand. Thank you. I'm so glad to have you here. Welcome to the Nehemiah's Temple. I'm Pastor Jones, and we're just grateful that you chose to be here with us today. And we trust that you're enjoying the service. Amen. Always glad to see my friend, his dear heart, Sister DeAmber Williams in the house. I was going to tell y'all mess with me. Y'all don't think that DeAmber going to be in the choir. Rock. Said, the word of the Lord is with him. So the king of Israel and Jehoshaphat and the king of Edom went down to him. And Elisha said unto the king of Israel, what have I to do with thee? Get thee to the prophets of thy father and to the prophets of thy mother. And the king of Israel said unto him, nay, for the Lord hath called these three kings together to deliver them into the hand of Moab. And Elisha said, as the Lord of hosts liveth, before whom I stand, surely were it not that I regard the presence of Jehoshaphat, the king of Judah, I would not look toward thee nor see thee. But now bring me a minstrel. And it came to pass when the minstrel played that the hand of the Lord came upon him. And he said, thus saith the Lord, make this valley full of ditches. For this saith the Lord, ye shall not see wind, neither shall ye see rain, yet that valley shall be filled with water, that ye may drink, both ye and your cattle and your beasts. And this is but a light thing in the sight of the Lord. He will deliver the Moabites also into your hand. And ye shall smite every fenced city and every choice city, and shall fell every good tree, and stop all the wells of water, and mar every good piece of land with stones. Dear God, we're grateful for your word. We thank you for blessing us to be here on this afternoon. Father, we know that you are our keeper. You are our way maker. We're grateful for everything that you do on our behalf. And Father, all the things that you have yet to do. We pray that you will continue to move, yes, in our midst. Father, I ask that you would bless your word, that your word go forth with power. I pray you would unctionize this vessel Help us, Father, to proclaim your word, to speak to your people. We ask that you would give ears to hear what you have to say. Father, prepare the hearts. Yes, Lord. And I pray that you would send forth a ready word, Lord God, in the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you for that. Glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Bless you. You may be seated. I'm going to read again verses 16 and 17, and it reads, "And he said, Thus saith the Lord, make this valley full of ditches. For thus saith the Lord, ye shall not see wind, neither shall ye see rain, yet that valley shall be filled with water. Yet that valley shall be filled with water." And this morning or this afternoon, for what I believe would be a brief space of time, I want to talk to you from this thought: if you do your part, he will do his part. Glory to God. If you do your part, he will do his part. Well, let us make no mistake about it. Our God is an incredible provider. I mean, he has made it very clear that he will always take care of his people. Amen. He's always moved on behalf of his people, and he really socialized and enculturated the children of Israel to understand him as provider. He wanted them to know that they could lean on him, that they could trust him, that they could depend on him, that they can look to him for their keeping, look to him for their every need. Why do you think that he takes them into the wilderness where they have no provision or no other substance or nothing else? They don't have a farm, they can't farm anything, they don't have cattle, they have none of that. But they're in the wilderness, and while they're there, God provides manna from heaven. He provides them with manna, and he gives them enough that they can eat every day. And on the day before the Sabbath, he would give them twice as much, so they wouldn't even have to gather on the Sabbath day. God made sure that he made that message very clear, that I'm not a God that just look to be worshipped in. I'm not a God that just want people to bow to me and to kowtow to me. As you see with so many idol gods, the idol gods, they expect their people just to render to them without rendering back, without receiving anything. But our God is not like that. He is the provider. Yeah, he is the source of our supply. Yes, he is able to meet all of our needs, and yes, and then some. And so we can't allow ourselves to let this reality lapse from our mind, that God is our provider. Because sometimes we start to think that we're responsible for providing for ourselves, that what we have we generate by our own hands, when God wants us to remember that it's him. Say, it's in him we live, we move, and we have our being. That he is the source of everything for us. You know, God wants us to know that we can depend on him, and that we can look to him for our keeping, for sustaining us. Oh yes, he's the one that's able to provide everything we need. Matter of fact, in Psalms 34:9 it says, "Oh, fear the Lord, ye his saints, for there is no want to them that fear him." There is no want to them that fear him. Look, brothers and sisters, part of the reason why we want to have and we have testimony services so that we can be reminded of what God is doing for his people. Yes, because sometimes you get in a place and you feel like he hadn't come by your house in a little while. You feel like he hadn't met your needs in a little while, that you have struggled in a little area, and that maybe you feel that you were going through a dry place, but you need to hear somebody else stand up and say, when I was on my last, God stepped in and healed me, or God stepped in and provided for me, that I had a need, and I was listening to Pastor Hill, and many of you don't know his testimony and how he had struggled and struggled losing houses and all those things. He's testified before of the challenges that he's going through financially and all of it. But if you look at him now, he's standing up there taking and as he said, Lord, I want to be the one to give the most tithes. But see, some of y'all are thinking, well, why you want to give the most tithes? If you're giving the most tithes, that means you're getting the most. Hallelujah. Yeah, that you are getting the most. That positions you to give the most. And when I tell you something, sometimes we don't realize you need to give the most so you can get the most. Oh, yeah, but I look at him now and I remember, you know, we've been constantly praying that he get gainfully employed and all those things. And I had to laugh with Lady B a few weeks ago, and she pointed out to me, not only did he get a job, but she got a job, and Malik got a job, and Micah got a job, and Marky going to school, everybody at the Hill House employed and paying tithes. Because our God is an awesome provider. I know that there are times when you start to question and you get a little worried and you get a little concerned because it hadn't come the way you thought it ought to come. It hadn't been as present as you would like for it to be present. Yes, but the reality is that we don't always know how, but we do know who. Lord, have mercy. You might as well tell somebody, I don't always know how, but I know who. I don't know how it's going to come all the time, but I know who's going to bring it. I know who my provider is. I know who my deliverer is. I know who my way maker is. I know who it is. I know who. And I know that he is watching out for me. I know that he is looking out for me. In Philippians 4:19, the Bible says to us, but my God shall supply all your need according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. Now, I don't know how you feel about that word, but and you can parse those words any way you want to, but when it says he'll supply all my need, all your needs, some of you may say, well, you know what, I'm just going to let that apply to my food, and I'm just going to apply that to this area of my life. I'm just going to apply it to this circumstance or to that issue, but I would rather take it as it says, he will supply all your needs. And my God, everything I need, I'm looking to him to supply. Whatever I need, I'm looking to him for the supply. I mean, yes, Lord God, my, because the Bible says that that's the kind of relationship we ought to have, and that's the kind of God that we ought to serve. And I want to pause right here just to make something very, very clear, because sometimes people want to treat God as a genie in a bottle, and that they rub it three times and they get the genie pop out and grant them wishes. And God is not like that. God is not about sending something, I'm waiting on you to just send a request, and so you can pop him around in heaven and have him doing this and have him doing the other. Oh no, but God is looking to, and as you looked at the previous verse I shared with you in Psalms, he says, oh, fear the Lord, ye his saints, his people that is saints, the set apart ones, those that have been set apart for his use, set apart for his glory, set apart for his power. Those who don't just come to God for his hand, but they want to see his face. And those that don't want to just get a benefit, but they want to be a benefit. They want to praise him. They want to magnify. They want a real relationship with him. Those that don't just want him on Sunday, but when they wake up on Monday, they want to know that he's present. They want to reach out to him and say, Lord, it's Monday morning. I know it's not Sunday, and I know I'm not over there at Nehemiah's temple, but I'm in my bedroom. But you know what? I still want to feel your presence. I want to know that you're here with me, even where I am right now. Lord God, I'm not interested in the kind of relationship that is only sometime when I feel like putting on my church clothes, and I feel a little churchy, and I want to go down and grab my Bible and go up to church and get a little warm, fuzzy feeling because I'm in the sanctuary. That's not the kind of relationship I'm looking for, Father. I'm looking for the kind of relationship that you're with me if I don't feel you with me. That I know that you're with me in my hard times, in my good times. That I know that you're walking with me no matter what's going on. Yeah, go on. You know, some people are happy with that touchy-feely and warm fuzzy kind of relationship. I don't know, but even God is not interested in that. He's not interested in the people that are not serious about walking with him. He said, these people draw near to me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. They're not interested in people that are not serious about a relationship. And you know, if you're serious, if you allow his word to guide you, not just on Sunday, but on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. Oh yes, that you allow his word to be your guide. That God, I'm going to live for you not just Sunday, and not just while I'm in church. Because some people can't even do the whole Sunday. They just going to do it while they're in church. Then when they leave church, they leave everything they learned in church. They leave everything they felt in church. No sir, but no ma'am. That's not what God is looking for. He's looking for some folks that want to be real with him, that want to take him to work with him, that want to live for him, want to drive in their car, that want him to be present in the middle of the night in their bedroom and nobody else is there. He wants somebody to mind if he pull up a chair in the living room. Some of us don't want him to pull a chair up in the living room because we're not doing things that we know he would be pleasing to him. So you want to leave him that church till you pick him up again, but that's not the kind of relationship that generates what you're looking for out of God. He said, my God, he said, perfect peace have they whose mind is stayed on me. Oh yes, your mind is stayed on him. And that's why he said, mark the perfect man, for the end of that man is peace. He said, when your ways please God, he'll make even your enemies to be at peace with you. That's where the power is. The power is where you have a real relationship. When you have a real relationship, then you don't have to worry about where your next meal coming from. You'll be like Elijah sitting up under the juniper tree, and a bird will bring you something to eat. So, I think it's important. I said I was going to stick a pin in that right there, didn't I? Went a little further than I thought. But God wants us to know that he's looking for people that or to have a real relationship with him. Amen. See the benefit of it. See the benefit of having a real relationship with God, being real with God. That like David said, oh Lord, restore unto me the joy of your salvation. Take not away your spirit from me. Don't cast me away from your presence. I want to be in your presence, and not just sometimes. I want to be in your presence all the time. I want to be one of them that have been sanctified by your word, brought in close to you, that's walking with God, that's walking with you each and every day, Lord God. I want my daily walk to be as you say. That the steps of a good man or woman are ordered by the Lord. Some people don't want God to order their steps, but you know what? I decided I walked long enough in my own direction. God, I decided to order my steps. Where do you want me to go? That's where I want to go. Where you want me to be, that's where I want to be. How you want me to act, that's how I want to act. I want to do the things you want me to do. I want to honor you not just with my lips, Lord, but with my life. And my life honor you, Lord. Oh, yes. And so, yes, those who are serious about their relationship with God, then God is very clearly your provider. He is very clearly the one. He wants you to trust him. He wants you to know you can lean on him. He wants you to know that you don't have to worry about things. He said, fret not yourself. Don't worry. I got you covered. He said, look at the sparrows. They neither sow nor they toil. Do they toil? They don't toil or reap. But I feed you. Jesus said, but your father feed the birds. Feed the birds, and aren't you worth more to him than a bird? Aren't you worth more to him than things that are sold for a farthing? You're worth more to him than that. Oh yes, and because of that, he's going to make sure that you have what you need. Well, give the Lord some praise right here. And so, in our lesson today, we have an episode, a historical account, where one of the kings of Israel is about to go to battle. He is the son of Ahab and Jezebel. Jehoram is his name, and he is the son, as I said, of Ahab and Jezebel. And Ahab was known for being one of the most wicked kings of Israel that ever lived. He was one that did not follow the will of God. He was one that brought in all kinds of venerable doctrines and idol worship. And a lot of that came from his wife Jezebel. Jezebel brought in the Baal worship and caused the whole people. This is something that people in leadership do, and this is what he did. Not only did he follow after Baal worship, but he caused the people to sin too, which was a terrible thing. But he was the king, and this was King Ahab and his wife Jezebel. And Jezebel was one that persecuted the prophets of God. And you remember that she chased after Elisha, and she we have that great historical account. The prophets of Baal going against Elisha, and Elisha standing on Mount Carmel and proclaiming the word of God and standing strong in the power of God and saying to the 400 prophets, you call on your God, and I'll call on my God, and the God that answered by fire, let him be God. And you know what happened, that the only God there is answered by fire. Oh yes, but Jezebel persecuted the prophets and wanted to destroy what God was doing. Their son son Jehoram became king of Israel, and he got rid of some of what his father and mother had done, but he maintained some of the idol worship, so he was a little better than them, but he still did not entirely bring the people back to worshiping God. He had been doing some things traditionally that they should have been doing, but he did not fully embrace what God wanted him to do. Oh yes, and so after Ahab, his father, died, he became the king. The king of Moab had been paying Ahab taxes. And Moab decided when Ahab died that he would stop paying the taxes. And as a result of King Jehoram, he decided that he wasn't going to allow that to happen. And so he's now king, and Moab have decided, king of Moab have decided that he's not going to pay the taxes. His name was Misha. Misha decided he's not going to do it. And King Jehoram decided, I can't let that happen. And so he prepares to go to battle. And before he goes to battle, he counts up Israel. When he counts, he realizes he doesn't have enough people to win the battle. And so what he does is, but I want you to know this, that he counts and makes a determination that they can't win, that they're going to need help. But his problem is, you can see that he's not considering God. He's not thinking about God at all. So he calls, he reaches out to Jehoshaphat. I don't want to say he calls, because some of y'all might think he had a cell phone. He didn't call, but he reached out to Jehoshaphat and said, would you fight with me? Would you go up against Moab with me? And Jehoshaphat was king of Judah, and he was a mighty warrior, and he honored God, and he was doing what God had told him. Matter of fact, you Pastor Price preached on this recently on some aspect of what Jehoshaphat did, but here he again, he says, I will go with you, the king of Israel. So the king of Israel and the king of Judah got together, and they went to go to battle against the king of Moab. Stay with me. I know some of this historical stuff is tedious, but I want you to have the background. I want you to understand what we're talking about here. I don't want to just go to the text and just preach the text without giving you context. Is anybody with me? Yes. So I want you to understand what is transpiring here. But I feel like preaching on today. Yeah, I want you to understand what is transpiring here. That these kings got together and they decided to go and fight against the king of Moab to make him begin to pay taxes again. And so they had to go through Edom, and they brought in the Edomites, and they brought the king of Edom. Now Edom, they were descendants of Esau. They were his descendants, and they were Edomites, and they had joined together. The three of them joined their groups together, and they went to go do battle against the king of Moab. But they circled the region. As a matter of fact, if you read the text, like in verse 9, it said they made a compass, and that's what it says in the English. But what that means is they circled the area. But what they were doing, they were looking for water. They were trying to find water. So they circled the area, and they could not find water nowhere. So they got no water for the soldiers. They got no water for the animals that they had. They had no water, and without water, they knew that they could not go to battle. You know, water is a significant thing, and especially in that day and time, their folks had to have water, and many times they were in desert places, and water was hard to come by. Oh Lord, but I think we got to remember that God had always used water to make sure his people knew who he was. That God would use water as a metaphor for his ability to provide. God used water, and when he turned the Nile, the blood sent a message to Egypt, let them know they're messing with the wrong God. Oh yes, so he turned the whole Nile River to blood. It was God told Moses Moses to stand at the Red Sea, and he used the Red Sea to demonstrate his power, that he's in control. Now, this is a precious commodity. It's a limited commodity. We think that it's everywhere. Everywhere is not drinkable water, but God is saying he's got control over all of it. He is fully controlled of what, you know, water can be a very dangerous thing. That if the water flood, if the area flood, then people need to know how to swim. And even if you can, you still might not make it. Water can be a very dangerous thing. But God uses water to demonstrate how powerful he is. It was God who told Moses that when the people of Israel were thirsty and in the wilderness, on two occasions, he told them to stand at the rock. One occasion, he told them to smite the rock. And when they hit the rock, enough water came out to feed thousands of people. Oh, yes. Then the next time, he told Moses to speak to the rock. But if you remember your Bible, that Moses, he didn't speak to the rock. He hit the rock again. That's why Moses couldn't go into the promised land. Because God said, you failed to sanctify me before the people. I told you to speak to the rock. Because I wanted them to know that it wasn't you bringing up water. I wanted them to know that it was me that brought the water. You didn't sanctify me in front of the people. So therefore, you're not going to go into the promised land. Oh, Lord, God is the one that provides the water. In Isaiah 43:20, and I'm almost where I want to be. It says, the beasts of the field shall honor me. This is God talking. See, the dragons in the house. Then he says, because I give water in the wilderness. And they said, and rivers in the desert to give drink to my people, to my chosen. So when I get you thinking about this a little differently, don't just think about water as water. I want you to think about it as provision. I want you to think about it as whatever you need. I want you to think about it as food if you're hungry. I want you to think about it as deliverance. Think about it as financial needs being met. Because God is saying, I'm the provider. Lord, have mercy. I can provide you whatever you need. Whatever you need, I can provide it. I'm the one that brought water out of a rock. I'm the one that can cause fish to give up money. I can put money in a fish's mouth. God is saying, I'm the one, even if you need a loan from the bank, before you go in the bank, I dare you to pray. Talk to the one that sits on every board. Talk to the one that's in charge of everything. He's got it all under his control. Oh, Lord. But the men here, they had decided we can't find water, so we can't go any further. We have no provisions. It's something that here is the king of Israel, but he didn't think, let me call on God. He didn't think, my God is able to provide all that I need. He didn't think about none of that. What he does is, he goes, woe is me. He said, God has brought us out here to be destroyed. He let us come out here to be killed. Oh, Lord. And then Jehoshaphat steps up, but he's the one that have a relationship with God. He's the one that know God as a deliverer. He's the one that knows that God is a way maker. You know, when the things are going helter-skelter and people can't figure out what to do, somebody that know God ought to say, hold on a minute, you're listening to your doctor, but I know another physician. Hold on a minute. They didn't far past your blooming dude. room, but I want you to know that I know somebody. I've been walking with him for many years, and I have discovered that he's a deliverer. I have discovered that he's a way maker. I have discovered I know somebody. Like David said, when my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to the rock that's higher than I. When I call you and I'm in trouble, I don't want you saying, oh, that sounds pretty bad. You in a bad shape. I want somebody to say, but I know Jesus. Yeah, I know Jesus is a way maker. I know the Lord will bring you out. Sometimes we get in a place where we don't have enough strength. We don't have enough wherewithal. The enemy has brought beat us, got us beat down and depressed, and it's hard for us to lift ourselves up. But we need somebody that will say, look to the hills from which comes your help. Your help coming from the Lord. So I can't look up. You gotta say, lift up your heads, O ye gates, and be ye ever lifted up. Lord, don't sit there in your circumstance. Don't sit there. You got the power of God. He's with you. You got the anointing upon your life. Don't you know who you are? Don't you know what you got? You got the Holy Ghost inside. You got power under control. Unleash the power. Unleash the power. Unleash the power of your problem. Unleash the problem. Wait, you see the phone going? I'm almost there. Hallelujah. I wish I'd be somebody praying with me for a few more minutes. Hurry up. Say, blessing, Lord. Hallelujah. Oh, yes. Thank you. Say, blessing, Jesus. Oh, yes. Hallelujah. Because I know when I need help, I want somebody to know who to call. Say, help him, Lord. Help him. Oh, Lord. Yes, help him. Oh, but God, Lord. My. So, Elijah says, it was Jehoshaphat. He said, is there not a prophet here? He asked a faithful question. He said, is there not a prophet here? In other words, is there not somebody that speaks for God? Is there not somebody that's got a relationship with God? Somebody that know the word of God. Is there somebody that can get a word from God? They get a word to God. Oh Lord, that's how you want to be. You want to be that somebody that can get a word from God. You want to be that somebody that can get a word to God. Oh Lord, he says, eyes are upon us and his ears are open to our cry. Oh yes, Lord have mercy. So Jehoshaphat said, is there a prophet around here? Lord have mercy. Look at here, Jehoram. Before you give up, let me check with the prophet. Before you throw in the towel, let me check. Let me check with the man of God. Let's get somebody to call on God. Before you give it all up, before you say it's all over, I want you to try God. I want somebody that's on their last. I want you to remember, before you throw in the towel, I dare you, just before you give up, just before you say it's over, say, oh God, you that dwelleth between the cherubims, you that sit on the mercy seat, oh God, I need mercy. I need you to move on my behalf. And if you ever been there when nobody else can help you, when you had nothing else to do. I had called everybody else. I had called on everybody else. I had turned, I went to my legs. I was on my legs and moved and decided, oh God, can't nobody else help me. If you don't help me, I won't be helped. If you don't deliver me, I won't be delivered. And so Jehoshaphat says, where is the prophet? And they told him, well, Elijah is here. And so Jehoshaphat said, let's go to Elijah. And they came to the man of God. And they began to tell him what the problem was. They said, we need water, but we have no water. They go to the man of God. Now he doesn't own a well. He is not, and does not have a river in his backyard. He does not have a house on the ocean bed. He, only thing he got is a relationship with God. All he got is a relationship with God. Somewhere on him, the only thing he got is the ability to call on God. The only thing he has that make him different than Jehoshaphat, it made him different than King Jehoram, is his relationship with God. And so they go to him, and Elijah looked at King Jehoram and looked at the king of Edom and said, what do I have to do with you? In other words, he wasn't going to do nothing for them, because he knew King Jehoram was worshiping calves. He knew King Jehoram had worship of idols. Matter of fact, he says, why don't you go to the prophets that your daddy worshiped? Why don't you go to the prophets that your mama had? Why are you coming to me? Why don't you go to your prophets? The prophets of Baal, Elijah's messing with them now. Elijah's messing with them. Because you have come to realize they the one God, they the one deliverer, they the one way maker. There's only one somebody that'll make a way in the desert. There's only one somebody that'll put water where there shouldn't be any water. There's only one somebody that can do the impossible. Nobody else, no one else can do what he does. And so Elijah looked at him and said, I don't want to do anything for you in so many words. But he looked up and he saw Jehoshaphat. And he said, because I see Jehoshaphat, because Jehoshaphat had been an honorable man, because he had done what is right, because he had did what he was supposed to do, I'm going to do something for you. I'm going to hear from the Lord and tell you what the Lord said. So he said, look, send for the minstrel, send for somebody to play music. And when he sent for the minstrel started to play. What you get this? He said, look, send for somebody to play some music. My God, this is Elisha, the mighty man of God. What is that? Why is that significant? Because he recognized the atmosphere need to be set right. I need to set the atmosphere. I want to hear from God. There's been evil all around here. And just like David played and drove away the evil spirits, I need somebody to come up in here and pray. Praise God. I need somebody to praise God with an instrument, because I want to hear from the Lord. That's why sometimes we got to have the praise team. Praise God. That's why we need the fire to be on point, because there's somebody in here next to the spirit. We need you to send them demons out of here. We need you to slay them demons out of here.
Filled with water. You won't know where it came from. And some people in their minds say, well, they're going to dig and the water going to come up from the from underneath the ground. That's you adding to the scripture. That's not what it says. What it says is that when they looked up the next morning, the water was there. They don't know where it came from. They don't know God is able to make something appear that wasn't there. Oh God, you're just saying this. If you do your part, I'll do my part. I want somebody to know if you live like I told you to live, I'll bless you coming, I'll bless you going, I'll bless you in the city, I'll bless you in the field, I'll bless you as you go, I'll bless you as you go. Do your part, do your part. Be holy, because I'm holy. Pray like I told you to pray. Fast like I told you to fast. Say my word, know my word, do my will. If you do your part, I guarantee you, he'll do his part. He never failed. Psalmist said, great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness.
This fight or flight.
Yes, sir.
So they looked up and the water was everywhere. They got water everywhere. But as the prophet was talking, he said something to them. He says, for this is a light thing with God. It's almost like saying, this is easy. You haven't even asked him for nothing hard. He said, this is easy. Yeah. Making water appear out of nowhere. This is easy. This is light work for God. He don't mind God. He didn't have to do much to make that happen. He didn't have to do a whole lot to make that happen. Some of us got some stuff that's hard for us. But God said, that's easy. That's easy. You're trying to fix your house. God said, that's easy. You got to come to me and let me do it. You're trying to turn something around in your life. You got a monkey on your back. God said, that's easy. That's an easy one. You ain't asked me nothing hard yet. That's an easy one. I'll turn it around for you. I'll fix that for you. Before you knew that you was in a problem, I'll change it. I'll lift you up out of it. I'll bring you forth. And oh God, you'll be looking back like that. That was easy. You know, God will do something, and it will be so easy. We'll look back and say, wow, that was easy. I know how I got through that. Don't know how I came out of all that. But here I am today. That was easy. Oh, Lord, God is able to make the crooked straight. He can bring mountains down. He bring valleys up. He can cut all of this by his power. And he'll be looking at him and saying, oh God, I don't know how you did it, but you did. I don't know how, but I know who. I don't know how you brought me out of darkness into the marvelous light. But I know you sent your son, and the son gave his life. I love the fact that our Bible recounts this historical accuracy that you have Israel and you have Judah, and they too follow different tracks so that we know which one to follow. We have Jacob, we have Esau, so we know which one to follow. You have Cain, you're able. So we know which one to follow. I'd rather follow Jehoshaphat, because he follows God. Yes. Yes. God is saying to us today, you want me to move? I want you to do your part. You don't want to dig ditches because it's hard. You know, in our society, they used to have a job description called ditch digger. That was an actual job. Those people got ridiculed for being ditch diggers. It was seen to be a lonely job. But there was benefits to being a ditch digger. They were getting paid all the time. They could take care of their family. Let me tell you what else happened with a ditch digger. They built big muscles. You dig. You're getting bigger and more fit. We can build our strength. Digging where God wants us to dig. Stop laying back. Well, we could be digging. I love Deacon Brown's testimony. Probably say, God said, I'm going to do it, but you know what I want you to do? Turn that TV off. Let me have some of the programs, some of the video games you're playing. Let me have some of that time. That's ditch digging. That's what ditch digging is. Push your plate back and say, I'm not going to eat today. And digging a ditch. Because I know if I do my part, he will do his part. If you be willing, let me see that in the text. If you be willing and obedient, if we keep his word, if we abide in him, and his word abides in us, if we do our part, he'll do his part. Sometimes I see people complain like, y'all keep preaching about this Christianity and how the Lord blesses people. And I've been saying for 2 weeks and I'm still in trouble. Why don't we give it a little more time? And why don't we do this? Keep praying. Keep coming around the saints of God. Keep coming around the saints. Keep learning how to do his word. There's so many things that God wants to do in our life. It's based on a preposition. If you do this, I will do that. People just want to take the last part of it. My dear, I hear them quote all the time. God said, you can ask for what you will, and he'll do it. Right. Then you leave out the whole first part that says, if you abide in me and my word abide, if you keep my commandments, then we won't leave that part out. We say, oh, that's insignificant. No, that's very significant. Very significant. You gotta put it all together. If we do our part, everybody in this Bible has been telling us he will do his part. God, for God is faithful, who will not forget your labor of love. God bless you.
He says in one part, cast your bread on the water. You got to do it if you want to get the benefits. As the altar workers are coming down, he said, cast all your cares upon him, for he cares for you. You have to cast them upon him. He says, come unto me, all you that labor and heavy laden, then I will give you rest. If you want to have the rest, you have to first come. You have to come. If you come, he said, I'll give you rest. You have to come. Is there anyone who wants to get baptized on a day? I know there were a couple of souls that said they wanted to get baptized. You can come down. Amen. If you want to get baptized, I know. Two of the rows who wanted to get baptized. So we do have clothes for them. They'll talk with you. If you want to get baptized, they'll talk with you. And you know how we believe altar calls for everyone. Maybe you need to be strengthened in your relationship. Maybe you've got a weak. Maybe you need to be restored. Whatever it is, the altar is open. You want to flood around the altar. Maybe you need to be renewed in your mind. You can come down. You need to be strengthened. You may have some things you're fighting, battling with. He's able to destroy everything. Won't you come? Come on down, come on down, come on down. The altar is open. The altar is open. The altar is open. I want to be baptized so far. I believe in maybe more. Put your hands together. Come on, he's here. He's here. You know we just have that thing we say, if you take one step, you come to him and he'll help you.
Thank you. Can someone go and pray? Elder Price, can you go and pray?